This is an example of avoidable interest for intermediate accounting. Assume a company took out a construction loan to construct special purpose equipment that they're going to use in their operations. Construction began on January 1st and concluded on December 31st. Of course, the dates are just there to make things easier for you, so you can make the assumption we're going to capitalize the entire year. Here's the information related to the actual expenditures and the dates the disbursements were made. The company took out a loan. Now, they had a special construction loan just for this. So while they spent $1.5 million, the construction loan was only for $750,000. They didn't really need to finance everything. There were other loans the company had. There was a bond payable, which was for 10 years, in the amount of $600,000 and 12% interest. And there was a 5-year note payable in the amount of $550,000 with 10% interest. The first two questions are, which loans qualify for the capitalization of interest? And in this case, this expenditure qualifies, and some of the money used for those expenditures qualifies. The capitalization period is during the year from January 1st to December 31st, because that's when the building process was ongoing. The question becomes, how much is going to become avoidable or actual interest? And if they're only going to borrow $750,000, how much would there really be? The idea begins with, if I was to borrow money, I would borrow this $210,000 for an entire year, because that amount was expense on the property building for an entire year. The $300,000 I didn't do for an entire year. I didn't really, if I was to borrow the money, I wouldn't borrow it until March 1st. So that was really 10/12 of a year. So if I'm going to calculate how much money I'm going to borrow or what would be avoidable interest, I would only have 10/12 of that I would use. It's kind of a math thing. The 10/12 of this would be my approximate accumulated expenditures for an entire year, or what we call weighted average accumulated expenditures. And you know, you need to make sure you mark that down as weighted average accumulated expenditures, and that you know that that's different from a weighted average interest rate. A quick way to explain this is, if I had a loan, and let's just say for purposes of this, at 12%. And on January 1st, I took it out for $100. My interest would be $12. If on July 1st, I took out another $100, it would be principal of 100 times a rate of 12% times time, and that would give me $6 in interest. So my loan for the year would be $18 in interest. But if I want to work it a little bit differently, and I say that really the $100 from January is going to be an entire amount of interest, I'm going to weight that as 100. The July is really only going to be $50 in interest, because I'm only using it for half a year. So I'm going to put my time in there, and I have $150. As my total weighted average expenditures, and I multiply that by 12% times 1 year, I still get the $18. So we're just simply readjusting the interest, because this makes for a totally easier computation. And that's why we take the expenditures that we were given at the beginning of the problem, and we concern ourselves with the months in the capitalization period. So if we're starting at January 1st, we've got 12 months. So I'm going to make that, my time is going to be 12 divided by 12, because that's actually for an entire year. On March 1st, I've got 10 months. Now notice February 28th and March 1st are going to be the same thing. So you have to really pay attention to the dates. But that's 10 twelfths of a year for my weighted average expenditures. On May 1st, I missed the first four months of the year. So I really have 8 twelfths of a year. And on December 31st, I may have made that $450,000, but if I were to take a loan from a bank, I wouldn't have any interest at all because it was on the last day of the year. So 0 divided by 12 in terms of my year. If I take my principal, which would be the amount of the expenditures, times my rate, which we're going to get to in a little bit, times time, I'm going to come out with this weighted average accumulated expenditures. So what I have is $820,000 is the weighted average that I would use for my interest rate in the amount of interest that I would pay on this construction loan. So notice, the company may have spent $1.5 million, but they've got $820,000 in the weighted average that they could take for the interest rate times the entire year. Don't forget, here's the loan amounts. So the construction loan is for $750,000. You should know immediately, wait a second, the weighted average of expenditures is $820,000 and the loan's only for $750,000. Well, a couple things come into play. Nobody ever borrows the entire 100% of the loan. And two, the company has other money put aside. But this is going to be something we're going to work on, because really, I'm going to work on that construction loan's my big deal. $750,000 is certainly allowable. But what about the additional $70,000 that I did have interest that I'm paying on? It must have come from either the company's cash or the other loans that were there. So these are the other loans that we mentioned earlier. But when I add the $127,000 plus the $112,000 from the construction loan, my total interest that I'm paying is $239,500. So my total of $239,000 is the total actual interest that I have paid during the year. Now, if we're going to stop and talk about how much is construction loan and how much is avoidable, it's the amount that I would have avoided if I didn't take out that loan. If we get back to the fact that I spent $820,000 and only had construction debt of $750,000, I need to do something with that extra amount of money. Maybe I use the funds from the bonds payable, maybe from the notes payable. Which one? And this is where things with manipulation come into play. So what happens is you figure out what's going to be the interest rate that you're actually paying. Well, if I take this $127,000 that I paid on my total other debt, and the $1,150,000, which is the total other debt, interest based on total debt, says my weighted average interest rate of the general debt is 11.04%. So what I have is I've got $750,000 that I have at 15% interest, and then really that extra $70,000 is going to be at the 11.04%. And that's what we calculate. This 820 is going to be the weighted average accumulated expenditures. This is going to be the 750 is going to be your construction loan. This amount here is only going to exist if the construction loan is less than the total expenditures. Now, we've got 70,000 in excess expenditures. We're going to multiply that by the weighted average rate we had. And we end up with the construction loan interest that would have been avoided if we didn't build a project of 112,500, and the additional 70,000 in interest or in principal, which would lead to 7,730 in avoidable interest. So my total avoidable interest is $120,230. Now, before we go on, I want to point out one thing. If by chance the construction loan was for more than the accumulated expenditures, and let's just say it was $850, I would not have anything in the additional loan expenditures. And my avoidable interest wouldn't be $850,000, it would be the $820,000, the lesser of the expenditures or the construction loan. But that's just in case you face a problem that looks like that. In our problem, we've already calculated avoidable interest of $120,230. And on the prior page, we had actual interest of $239,500. So we capitalized the lesser of the two. Remember, conservatism principle, we'd rather get the expenses out now anyway, but conservatism principle says the least amount. And this actually, by allowing this, gives you the least flexibility and least ability to manipulate your numbers by taking out loans that you might not need. So you're going to capitalize the lesser of these items. And what you end up with is a debit to equipment, and that's how we're capitalizing it, and a credit to interest expense. Now, the reason I'm crediting interest expense is because it's assumed that during the year, I actually debited interest expense for the $239,500, and I credited cash when I paid that amount. So all I'm doing now is taking it out of interest expense, because my total interest expense for the year is going to be the difference. I'm taking out the $122,300, the amount that I've capitalized. And interest expense is going to be much less than that. So the final thing about this problem is, remember, it's the lesser of the avoidable interest and the actual interest. And also, make sure you're aware of what entries were made during the year so you can adjust your interest expense accordingly.